Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to go over the basics of the smoke generator in Blender 2.82. There are a few differences in the 2.82 version over earlier versions, and I'll highlight those as I go through. So to begin with, let's just add a mesh to the scene, which will form the basis of our smoke generator. And I'll cover fire as well as I go along. So you can use any mesh, and I'll just add a UV sphere, and I'll scale it down a little bit and just apply the scale to that. It's perfectly possible, of course, to go and create your smoke simulation entirely from scratch, but really, for the majority of cases, that's not necessary. You can just go and get Blender to do the basic setups for you, and that's what we'll do here. So I've clicked Object, I come down to Quick Effects, and I say Quick Smoke. So you can immediately see, even though we're not in wireframe view, that the object has become a wireframe object and we've got a wireframe box appeared around it. So this item, this object that we created initially, this sphere, will become the source of the smoke. There are a couple of different ways of sourcing smoke. And this cube or box is the domain of the smoke, where the smoke simulator will be created. It's not infinite, it just doesn't go out into an infinite space because calculations have to be done as to where particular parts of the smoke are, the volumetric elements of the smoke, and where they are not. And you have to define a finite space for those calculations to take place. Otherwise, it would be an infinite amount of calculation and Blender would never be able to do it. Now, with earlier versions of the smoke simulator, since you had a basic simulation set up and pressed play, you would start to see a smoke simulation. The default settings for Blender 2.82 actually don't show that, although you can configure it to. So if we go back to the beginning and we come down to here, and you can see here is our smoke simulation settings for the domain, because the domain is what I've got selected at the moment. There's two domain types, there's gas and liquid. Liquid obviously is for the fluid simulator, and that'll probably be my next tutorial. But for this case, we're doing smoke and fire, so therefore it's a gas simulation. This should be pretty similar in as much as we've got the basic resolution of the smoke to start with. And you notice we've got a new bake button just down here. We've also got border collisions. So border collisions is essentially how do you want the smoke to behave when it hits the edge of the domain. If none of these are selected, it will just flow through that border and disappear as if the border wasn't there. And that's likely to be how you want it to behave in the majority of cases. But if you want it to behave as though there's a roof over it, you might click the top border collision, or if you want it to be completely enclosed within the box, you might tick all of these, and then it will effectively fill up this box with smoke or fire. I'm not going to go into every single setting on this occasion, but you can see we've got things like buoyancy, density, and heat. So heat, obviously, the higher the heat, the faster things will rise. And vorticity, this adds the sort of swirls to the smoke and so on. Dissolve means that after a patch of smoke has been emitted, it will slowly disappear, a bit like steam coming from a kettle perhaps. So it will only rise so far before becoming invisible. Adaptive domain we'll come to in a moment, and noise we'll come to as well. I haven't really explored guides yet. Now, by default, Blender will select a location for its cache file, which is the file where it stores the results of its simulation calculation, and you don't necessarily need to change that. Although if you want to be able to use this again in future, you may want to specifically set a cache file. To get back to what I was saying about the difference in the way that the new smoke simulator works, we notice that the default type is modular. So what that means is two things. One is when we press play, we don't get any smoke sim by default. But also it means if we start to bake the data, which is essentially how we need to get what we need to do, and if we stop halfway through, we can start again or continue baking from the point at which we finished baking before. So that's quite handy. If I say bake data here, and you can see the little progress bar there and there, and I'm going to press escape to stop it. So you can see we've got a smoke simulation up to a certain point. So if I press play there, you can see it goes so far and then it stops. So it stops somewhere around frame 40, and there's no more simulation. However, if I press resume here, it will resume baking from the point at which it stopped up to the point at which I've told it to finish baking. Now, the default setting now, instead of the 250 that it used to be, is now 50 frames. Perfectly possible to change that, but by default, you'll just get 50 frames of simulation. If you want it to be a lot more than that, so if I wanted it to be the full 250, I'd set that there. But let's set this to 100. I think that's enough, and we'll just have our animation at 100 frames. So I'll put 100 in here. And now if I press play, obviously I've still only got 50 frames of baking. But if I now say resume up here, it will resume from that 50th frame and go on all the way to the end to give me my whole 100 frames of bake. And we'll just wait for that to complete. So I can now press play, and there we go. And for the whole 100 frames, we've got our simulation running. We can also start later than frame one if we want to. So we can set here the frame at which we start doing the simulation. So again, that's useful if we don't need the smoke stroke fire sim for the whole animation. So I'm going to set this back to 50 frames now, and I think I'll set my whole animation back to 50 frames. And we'll scroll down a little bit now. So I talked about adaptive domain. Once you've baked, you can't use that. So we'll free the data, and there is a slight pause when you do that, when you've got a larger simulation. So just don't think it hasn't worked, just give it a moment. You can see progress down here. So I'll now click adaptive domain, and then I'll click bake data. And when I press play after it's finished baking, you'll see what adaptive domain has done. So you can now see we've got a small box. So it's not the same size as the original box we had for the domain. And when I press play, you'll see that box grow. So the idea of this is that you create a domain limited by the maximum domain size you've defined, but that is as small as it can be to mean that the Blender doesn't have to do many calculations. So essentially, Blender is calculating for every little voxel, which is a bit like a pixel but in 3D, within that box, whether or not it should have some smoke and what direction that smoke's moving in and so on. So if you make that box smaller, it doesn't have to do so many calculations. So by having an adaptive domain, you're reducing the amount of work that it has to do and therefore speeding up the process of creating the simulation. It doesn't make any difference to rendering, but it does make a difference to baking. So with a higher resolution, more complex simulation, that can save you some time. So once we've baked, we might want to increase the resolution of that. So this at the moment is the default 64 divisions for the resolution, which is a relatively low resolution. In previous versions of Blender, we were able to select a button called High Resolution. Now I'm going to free the data here, because in the past we would select our basic resolution, perhaps play around with that a bit, and then we would turn on High Resolution, which to all intents and purposes, that's what this noise option is here. So I've clicked that, and we would think, okay, I'm just going to press Bake. That's going to take a few seconds just to bake through the animation, and then I'll press Play. Now you notice, although our adaptive domain is moving, we can't see anything. And the reason for this may be a slight bug in it possibly, but essentially what you need to do is bake your lower resolution animation first and then add in and bake your noise animation. So all we've effectively done is baked our low res animation, but it's not displaying anything because we haven't baked our high res animation yet. So by turning the noise option off, I haven't rebaked, but you can see there is our animation. But with that option on, it's trying to display the high resolution version, and we haven't created one yet because we haven't baked it here. So if I now press bake noise, it's effectively taking that bake and doing additional calculations on it, which are not quite simulation. They are adding noise into the simulation to make it look like it was a higher resolution simulation than it really was. I don't know whether it'll be really that visible here, but nevertheless, there it is. And yes, it is. So that now already looks like a better quality animation. We can really see the swirls going up there, and there's a lot more going on in that simulation, even though it's still only 64 divisions. So that's one little thing that may catch you out. remember that if you've got the noise option selected, you do need to bake noise as well. So I'm going to turn the noise option off for a bit, so we've gone back to our lower resolution, and I'm going to free the data of the bake, and you can see it's disappeared there. Now I'm going to select our object in the middle. This is where the smoke is emitted from. We have a number of different options. We have domain, flow, and effector. I'm not going to get into effector at the moment, but domain, obviously that's the area within which smoke is generated, and that's the big box we've got. So essentially it's just flow. Flow is all we would most likely want to use. And then the flow behavior, we have inflow, outflow, or geometry. Not going to worry about geometry today, but essentially inflow is smoke will be emitted from this object. Outflow is that any smoke coming into contact with this object will disappear. Substeps allows us to calculate how the smoke might be moving between, say, frame 1 and frame 2. Normally it would calculate from frame 1 to frame 2 and then from frame 2 to frame 3. But if we put a substep of 1, it will calculate where is the smoke at frame 1. Then it will go to frame 1.5, if you like, and say how did it move there. And then it will go to frame 2 and say how did it move between 1.5 and 2. So although it doesn't actually obviously display those subframes, it's working them out. And that can give you smoother motion, especially when you've got perhaps this smoke emitting object perhaps moving around very quickly. If it's moving quite quickly, you may get pulses of smoke because the distance it's moved between one frame and the next is quite significant. By increasing the subframes, that allows you to smooth that out. Smoke color and things like that doesn't matter too much at this stage, but what we may want to change is flow type. So currently it's just set to smoke. I can set it to fire, and then I need to go to my domain and bake that data. And pressing play on that, immediately you can see I get a quick representation of fire. I just selected fire for this, and obviously you can select fire or smoke or fire and smoke. And just as we did with the smoke, you can of course add a noise element into that and say bake noise. It's quite useful to be able to bake noise separately from the main bake, because in the previous version you had to either have the high resolution option on and then do your bake or not. Whereas now you can bake your lower resolution option, and then when you're happy with the way things are all set up, then you can add in your higher resolution option. And you'll notice there's an up-res option down here, so you can, that's effectively the increase in resolution. You can increase that perhaps a little bit at a time until you get where you want to get. So if we have a look at that now, it's obviously reading a lot more data, so taking a little bit longer. We're only getting 4 frames a second at the moment, but nevertheless you can see we've got a much better simulation. But what does that look like in render terms? So I'm in cycles render at the moment, and you can see I don't really have anything appearing right now. So I've opened another window, and I'll go to the shader editor, and by default this is what we get. Now because I've got no smoke defined, nothing's appearing. If I go back to here, and let's make this a smoke and flame option. So instead of just fire, we'll say fire plus smoke. Go back to our domain, free the data, and bake, and then turn on our noise and bake that. And if we just play that for a little bit, you can see we're getting something appear. Not really seeing the flame very clearly at the moment. If we go into simple preview mode, there we can see our flame, and you can see we've got a puff of smoke at the top there as well. When I go into rendered view, we don't seem to have any flame at all. We do, however, have some smoke. I'm going to add a lamp into the scene now. We'll just make it a simple sun lamp, and we'll make it quite bright, make the angle quite small so shadows are quite sharp, and let's make it 10 brightness. And then we'll go to the background and we'll set that to black. So there we can see our shadows, but we can't see any flame at the moment. We let it go on a little bit, but we know we've got flame there, but if we look here, we can see it up there. So selecting our domain again, what we need to change in order to be able to see the flame, this is the principled volumetric shader, by the way, and it's got both the options for fire and smoke in it. Density relates to the whole simulation, but will initially affect mostly the smoke. And you see there's our smoke color there. So I could brighten that smoke up a bit by going for more of a white look. Currently, black body intensity is set to 0. If I set that to 1, suddenly you can see we've got some fire going on in there. If I zoom in a bit, What this means, black body, is essentially it is an object that emits light simply because it is hot. So you can imagine a piece of metal that's been heated up to the point that it's starting to glow. That's what black body intensity relates to. And so it's, if you like, a close approximation of what real fire looks like, because the light from fire is only there because something is hot. It's not being emitted like an LED through some other electrochemical process. It is purely because it is so hot that the processes going on within the material cause light to be emitted when it is very hot. And you can actually go higher than one. You can click in there and you could put 10 in, and you can see you get extremely bright fire then. And we've got a temperature here. So essentially that temperature and that black body intensity is what sets how the flame works. So I put that back to one, but I set the temperature up to 5,000. I guess that might be degrees here. You can see we get a completely white flame. If I set it to 250, we've got no flame at all at black body intensity of one. So I guess it might be just emitting infrared. But when I put that up to 10, we can see we're starting to get a slight shade there now. Put it up to 100 and now we're getting a red sort of effect being emitted. So if I can set that to 2 and perhaps set this back to 1,000, we're getting a nice little fire and smoke simulation created there. So the only other last little thing that we need to look at, if I come back to here, I select my object here and I'm just going to put a particle system on it. So I've selected particle systems here and we'll just say 1,000. And if I just go back to the beginning and press play, you can see they're very big particles at the moment. Maybe we'll make it 300 particles and they'll end at frame 50, but we'll make them a tenth of the size that they currently are. So you can see we've still got our flame simulation going on, but we've got some tiny little particles being emitted there. So I'm going to stop that and I'm going to go to the physics on the particles. I'm going to go to the field weights of the particles and I'm just going to put -0.1 for the gravity. So what that will mean is rather than simply dropping, the particles will actually start to float upwards. You should just be able to make them out there. So they're being emitted and then floating upwards. Now I'm going to go back to the physics properties and I'm going to select flow source. And currently it's mesh, so it's the whole object itself. And I'm going to change that to particle system and then select the particle system I just created. I'm going to need to rebake, obviously. So I've gone back to my domain and I'm going to say free data. Take a second and I'm going to turn off noise for the moment and I'm going to say bake data. We'll give that a moment. And if we press play now, you can see we're getting little flames and what have you being emitted by those particles. And of course, if I now bake in noise, that will give us an higher resolution simulation. And I'm still doing all of this with the relatively low number of divisions of 64. As you start to increase that, of course, you get a much finer simulation. But you don't want to go any higher than you really need to. So if we press play now, you can now see we're getting this interesting smoke and fire simulation being emitted by those particles. And if we look at the rendered view, there it is. Now, as I said, obviously this is a relatively low resolution simulation. That's why it's a little blurry. And there are other things you can do to improve it as well, such as using denoising. But hopefully that's given you a quick introduction to some of the basic elements of generally noise of smoke simulation within Blender and some of the differences between Blender 2.82 and earlier versions. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well. And I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.